Positive music, meaning any style that makes you feel good, recruits the reward system. The peak pleasure moments in music can induce chills, as you learned in the last video. But chills are not the only indicator of musical enjoyment. All kinds of emotions, from the basics like happiness, sadness, anger, tenderness, and fear, to more subtle feelings like jealousy, pity, and even shame, can be induced by music. Activating the reward system depends on the value assigned to the music by the listener. That means that executive functions like memory, analysis, and judgment are involved in music-induced emotions. Executive functioning is handling the burden of attention and task demands. When a listener is busy or distracted, music can't get the neural resources that it needs to make a strong connection to the reward system. This is why we say that context matters when it comes to musical love. The so-called best song is the song that you are in the mood to hear. Sensory systems, like our eyes and ears, must provide good information to the brain to let it predict upcoming events. Therefore, we automatically compute incoming information and get ready to respond. Some things are harder to predict than others. As you saw in a previous video, if a stimulus is disorganized or rapidly changing, the chaos is difficult to follow, and it's therefore unpleasant. The opposite is true. The brain gets irritated by stimuli that do exactly what we think it will, like, for example, cliched lyrics or an overly repetitive chorus. A blend of novel and familiar items is what makes most music enjoyable. Popular music styles introduce just enough surprise that we can predict some of what's going to happen, but not all of it. Prediction is key to musical enjoyment. Rhythm lets us know when a change is most likely to happen, and tonality lets us know what sort of shift the melody might do. The brain loves making an accurate prediction about an upcoming reward, and is disappointed when music unfolds in such a way that no reward arrives. Musical pleasure, therefore, has three stages: generating expectations, anticipating when something good will happen, and experiencing the joy or disappointment from the prediction. In the case of a song you're hearing for the first time, the intro sets the tone for what kind of music it is. Experience with music lets you decide within seconds whether or not you'll like it. As the music plays, you listen for what you predicted. By the end of the song, you will have either confirmed or violated your expectations. This song is either better, worse, or just about what you thought it would be. This happens even with familiar songs, which is why we can listen to a favorite song many times and still enjoy it. Technically speaking, memories are crude neural traces representing prior events or objects. As we all know, our memories are incomplete. Even when you know a song well, there are still details missing. As you listen to a familiar song, you're comparing the active neural trace of what you're hearing with your memory of it, delighting you with the fact that hearing it is even better than you remembered. And of course, your anticipation of a dopamine treat is greater with familiar music. As you anticipate an exciting moment, as with familiar songs, or when you predict that a novel song might have a peak moment coming up, your nucleus accumbens gets more active, receiving some dopamine in anticipation, and this feels good. The anticipatory dopamine release is naturally less likely to happen when you hear a piece of music for the first time. That's one reason that listeners don't typically fall in love with a song on first listen, but when it happens, it can feel like love at first sight. We will continue with a description of the mechanism of music and emotion in the next video.